So, welcome to the next talk. After this talk, if you head over to the Hardware Hacking Village, HEVOCon should be going on, so go see some robot battles after that. It's also lunchtime after this talk, so have fun wherever you go for lunch. Other than that, contest still going on. Outside t-shirts are going to close up in a couple hours, so if you want a fancy layer one t-shirt, not this one, this is like 2005 or something. But all the new t-shirts are available outside. If you're looking for recordings of the talk, the gentleman outside with Media Archives will sell you all of the talks from the conference for $40 on this very fancy looking thumb drive. You can also get individual talks for $5. So make sure to talk to them. Also visit all of our fabulous vendors and sponsors out there. Show them some love. Up next we have Adam Donenfeld, is that correct? Okay, thank you. With OEMs considered harmful, hello new OD. So give him a big round of applause.
Can you hear me? Okay, thank you very much for coming. And today I'm going to present to you a research that we have conducted on OEMs called now. My team was supposed to join me, but it is ditched in the last minute, so. Okay, so the agenda for today, first we'll talk about OEMs in general. The OEMs in general, their position in the Android ecosystem, their effect on your devices, and the differences between the various OEMs. Then we'll analyze two different zero-day vulnerabilities that we found in OEM code, and finally we'll give out conclusions and see how we go for them from here. So, a little bit about myself. My name is Adam Donenfeld. I've been a security researcher for years, both in the mobile and in the PC field. I've mainly done vulnerability assessment and exploitation. Currently, I work in Checkpoint Software Technologies as a security researcher for Android. And in my free time, I also study German. So, let's talk about your device. What do you actually get when you buy a new Android device? So first we have the Linux kernel with slightly few modifications like the binder, power management, and wake locks. Then we have the Android project, abbreviated AOSP, Android Open Source Project. And the project is maintained by Google and it can be viewed by anyone. It contains framework for expanding Android and the essential user mode code for the operating system. Next, we have the chipset code. The chipset code contains both kernel drivers for the hardware, like camera, GPU, etc. And also user mode code for communication with the hardware. Next, we have the OEMs, which customize the devices. Their unique features come in the form of hardware features, like, for instance, the LG power button on the back of LG devices, or the head screen in your Samsung Android, but also in software modifications such as differences between the UI or different pre-built applications. Now it's important to mention that some devices share the same feature with a different implementation. Finally, we have the carrier, which sometimes push a billing application, perhaps they rebrand the device, print the logo on the device, but nothing really special. Okay, so the OEMs market share in the United States is fragmented unequally. So there are a few large OEMs which share the marketplace among themselves. So it's enough to find a vulnerability in a major OEM to affect a large portion of the market. Now, over the years, OEMs were known to have a low standard of security, and therefore their code was validated in a search of vulnerabilities. However, as the time passed, this problem received more awareness and efforts were made to improve the security of the OEMs. These efforts came both from third-party contributors, the OEM themselves, and also from Google. So, Google started to enforce security mechanisms into Android, and it greatly increased the security standard of all the OEMs. An example for a security mechanism that I personally really liked is CTS, or compatibility testing cert. CTS is a unit testing framework for vulnerabilities. So once a vulnerability is published, A test is written to check whether the vulnerability still presents on the device or not. Now, all the devices must pass this that test. If a device doesn't pass it, it won't receive a certification from Google, and therefore it will lack many essential features such as Google Play, Google Hangouts, and etc. So Google is protecting us. Third-party developers contribute to the security of Android, and OEMs are getting better and better. Android is safe or not? According to AndroidVulnerabilities.org, Edge received the highest score for being a secure OEM. Now we decided to see whether this score is justified or not, and therefore we started a short bug hunting project in Edge. Now, there are two main attack vectors when targeting mobile devices: local attacks vector and remote attacks vector. Local attacks vector mean that once I have an application installed on your device, I can elevate my privileges to gain capabilities which I'm not supposed to get. For instance, an innocent flashlight application is not supposed to be able to read your phone history or contact list. So this is the local attacks vector. Remote attacks vector mean that when having a unique identifier of your device, it can be your phone number, IMEI, IMSI, it can even be an email address that is associated with the device, and I can coordinate my attack specifically against an identifier and therefore against the device. Now, usually the user interaction in this kind of attacks is from minimal to nothing, and therefore this attack vector is considered much more dangerous. However, with that said, these kind of attacks are usually much more complicated and therefore not so common. So let's start with the local attacks vector. So I have an application installed on a device, my innocent flashlight application. There are many ideas that we can start working on, like privileged services that have no file permission, native memory corruptions, non-standard services like Unix sockets that accept connections and can be attacked, and so let's talk about bind permission. Android allows applications to export functionality to other apps using services. However, obviously, an app will not want everyone to access its sometimes privileged capabilities. So the bind permission feature allows us to restrict the use of this exported functionality. Now, this feature is used both by Android native apps, OEM internal services, and even by third-party applications. An example for the use of this feature, let's say that you want to read the call history of the phone. Now, the service that provides this information is protected by a bind permission. So only if you have this specific permission, you can access this data and read whatever you want. So how does it actually work on the device? So Facebook exports a service called cross-logon service. This service allows to log out users from the Facebook application. Now, let's say that we use Facebook Messenger and we log out from Facebook Messenger. Facebook Messenger will log out to this service and log users also from the main Facebook application. However, obviously, our innocent flashlight application is not supposed to be able to access this service, and therefore, if we try to access it, we receive a permission denied exception. Now, how do we obtain this permission? We have to be signed by the same developer key as Facebook's developer key. So since Facebook and Facebook Messenger share the same developer key, Facebook Messenger can access this service. Now, with this in mind, let's start research. So we went through all the OEM applications which export some sort of functionality but have no bind permission. Now, this is common because sometimes not all the services are privileged and therefore not all of them require a bind permission. So we saw this LG ATC in this service component. And now this service is high privileged and nobody is actually supposed to access it. And we have no idea actually what's even there. So obviously, as we've seen before, if we will try to access it, we're supposed to receive a permission denied exception, but we don't. We can access this privileged service, use its high capabilities, and eventually attack the system. So what can we do once you're connected to the service? We can start communicating with ATD or AT&T Mobile. Now, what is ATD? So ATD is a user mode high privilege daemon that is written by Qualcomm and therefore is distributed to all Qualcomm-based devices. Unfortunately, there's no source code available for this daemon, so we had to reverse generate to understand how to communicate with it. Now, it's the main gateway communication to the firmware. We're talking mainly about the Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, the GSM modem, but also to MiniOS, which is an internal service, an internal interface, to test the device. But now, the most important thing about it, it's connected to LG AT&T in the service, which we are connected to, thanks to the missing byte permission. So, what can we actually do once we are connected to AT&T? We can start with private identifiers such as IMEI, Bluetooth address, serial number, etc. And it can help us maybe coordinate our attack. We can also write this allegedly written private identifiers. We can remove the device without any prompt notification, and therefore we can prevent the user from doing stuff we want, like deleting us. We can switch between the different USB modes, and therefore we can prevent the device from being connected to the computer, and just prevent like backup or firmware upgrade. And we can even go more offensive. We can wire the device again without any prompt notification. We can break it so the user can abuse it again. And my favorite, we can permanently lock the device's GSM modem, and this is also persistent after a while. Now, combining all this together, we can create a very harmful type of viruses at a cost of zero permissions. So, the exploit flow, I'm a malicious application, a non-privileged malicious application installed on an LG device, and I want to connect to LG ATC in the service. So, since there is no byte permission protecting the service, I can simply connect to it and start communicating with it. Now, let's say that I want to permanently lock the GSM modem. I am simply sending this request to LG ATC in the service. It passes along this request to ATD, which eventually locks the GSM modem. And that's it. It's pretty basic. Now, we reported this vulnerability to LG. They were very collaborative. They issued a fix. We received the CV number for it. And if you run the newest version of LG, you are protected. Otherwise, any innocent version application or tic-tac-toe game can exploit this vulnerability against you. So, we found a locally exploitable vulnerability. Let's aim higher now. So, as I said before, remote attacks are much more complicated and the attack vector is relatively narrow. So, how do we actually start? We decided to go for all the Edge applications which we can remotely communicate with, knowing just the phone number of the device. So, remember, I spoke about the private and the unique identifier. We chose the phone number in this case. So, these applications can be identified because they must have at least one of these vulnerabilities, one of these permissions that you see here. From the list here, the Wapush is the most interesting one because there's lots of binary data that has to be processed in comparison to the rest of the permissions. So, before we talk about Wapush, we have to understand first, how text messages work. So, all the text messages are based on a protocol called PDU. PDU defines many properties in a text message, and not just the text itself. For instance, the sender, the receiver, is the text is ASCII, is it unicode, what's the length of the text, and etc. Now, an advantage for us in this method of communication, the mobile carrier doesn't run any verification checks on the PDU, other than checking the sender and the existence of the destination number. It means that lots of binary data will be processed on our victim. Now, here's an example of a PDU message. I'm not going to teach you how PDU is structured exactly. I'm just trying to convey here that PDU is a complicated protocol with a lot of fields. Nobody likes it, and therefore it can be an interesting place to search for vulnerabilities. So now let's talk about what is the way to transfer binary data over the mobile wireless network. So whether you know it or not, you use or use it a lot. MMS are based on WAP, carrier connectivity information. When you switch to a new carrier receive a new SIM and you receive this public message. It's also based on WAP. The V-cards that were popular a decade ago are also WAP-based. And the old mobile websites were also based on WAP. And in order to access these old websites, another WAP-based protocol called WAPUSH was invented. So what can we actually do with WAPUSH? We can transfer URLs to the device. We can transfer expiration dates for these URLs because a decade ago, URLs meant to be expired. Since this kind of message were only supposed to be sent by the mobile carrier, two important features also came in this protocol: an update feature and a delete feature. So basically, we could update any existing WAP push message on the device, both the URL and the date. And we can also delete an existing message if it was expired prior to its expiration date. So most of the OEMs implemented WAP push in the same way. It was some native library. But LG, on the other hand, they implemented it in a package called WAPService.apk. And it's the unique implementation. So was the unique vulnerability. So let's go into WAP service and see how it processes this message. So here you can see that it's from the manifest of this package. You can see that .push receiver handles the WAP push messages. So let's see the code of the push receiver. So as you can see, the code flow goes eventually to sender validity check main. I'll summarize it for you. Eventually, we get two main functions: process SI message and process SL message. Both are sub implementations of the WAP push protocol that contain the same vulnerability. So I'm going to show you the vulnerable code and give you a few seconds to see if you can find it yourself. The vulnerability is both in the update and in the delete feature. So this is the update code, this is the delete code. You have a few seconds to see if you can find it by yourself. It's not so complicated. Okay, so pushHandler.siid is the identifier of the message, and if you supply no identifier, so our URL becomes the identifier. So what happens if I send this URL? So there is an SQL injection vulnerability which we can remotely exploit. So we can delete or update any text message on the device, regardless if it's a WAP push message, and we don't even have to be the sender of the message. We can update or delete any message on the device. So how to exploit this vulnerability? In order to send an update or delete message, the device must already have a pre-existing WAP push message. So we don't want to take any risk. We will first just send a normal WAP push message. So now, once you're sure there is a WAP push message on the device, we can send the update or delete message against any existing normal message. So we send the request, and we can update or delete any message in the incoming text messages inbox. So, and we reported, we responsibly disclosed this vulnerability to LG, and they fixed it, and we received the CVE number for it. If you have the newest version of LG, you are protected, but otherwise, I can start deleting your text messages right now. So, let's see a demo of the delete vulnerability. On the right, we can see, on the right is the victim. We just have to know the phone number of the victim. And on the left, there is the attacker. The attacker is connected to a GSM modem, so it can send a raw PDUs to the victim. Now, as I've said before, there must be an existing WAP push message on the victim. So first, we will send a normal WAP push message. So, as you can see, the victim received a text message, a to a push message. Now it's important to mention that from this point on, I can start to exploit the vulnerability immediately. I just have to make sure that there is one push message on the victim. But just out of curiosity, let's see how the message looks when you open it. Okay, so as I've said before, this kind of messages were only supposed to be sent by the mobile carrier, and therefore there is no phone number, there's just service message. Now, a new update is available is the text that I chose. I could put any text that I want. Now, let's open it just to see how it looks on the inside. Okay, so obviously, you won't receive any update from Mitre to your device. Again, you can control the URL. Now, let's start to delete some text messages. Unless you have the newest version of LG, if you want to protect yourself, you have to turn on airplane mode, take out the SIM into a non-LG Android device, receive the malicious text messages there, and then plug your SIM back to your LG device, which is pretty unpractical. Now, there are lots of malicious activities that we can do with this vulnerability. For instance, let's say that they hacked your bank account and they changed your password. And you receive this, your bank account password has been changed message, and I can just delete it. I can even aim higher and use it for a remote ransomware tool, for instance, like you can delete all your text messages, and then send you a new text. If you want your text back, pay me, otherwise I will remotely wipe your device, and it's for the delete the message, and there's many other ideas. Now, updating the inbox and text messages is even more powerful. It's possible to craft sophisticated phishing attacks. For instance, let's say that your bank sends you a message to download a new version of Android app. I can just modify this text to include my malicious URL, so it will look exactly like this. Now, my URL can point off to a malicious application or just to a regular website, which I fully control, and I can trick the user to get into entries. Sensitive credentials. Now, makers like GMBath and Scout do that a lot locally, so doing it remotely is even more powerful. Okay, so we found both a locally exploitable vulnerability and a remotely exploitable one. How much time do you think that this entire research took us? So, it took us just 5 days. This is ridiculous. It's not because we are good. Well, good, but that's not the main reason. OEMs are still not securing the devices enough, and we still can't trust them. We need a better solution for security, but with that said, if you compare the situation to 5 years ago, it's much more complicated to find vulnerability in OEM's code, but still, there's good to be done because it's not so complicated to find it. So, thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed the presentation. Questions? Yeah, that's a question that everyone asks. Unfortunately, you can only delete or update the messages. We wanted to include like an insert SQL query, so we can like, for instance, send a new message to our phone with the existing data, but Android are very good at this, so they limit the SQLite on the device and we can only delete or update the messages, unfortunately. Good question. So, since we have like a complete control over the well calls in the SQL query, we can just like, for instance, send phone number equals what we want, or body equals any text that we want. So we can identify, we can coordinate our delete command against specific identifiers of the message. So we can't read it, but we can for instance, delete any message that starts with, I don't know, Bank of America or contains Bank of America. So we can somehow coordinate the attack. Any more questions? Yes. Okay, so it depends. I come from Israel and we can't find this update yet. And if you try to update it from your computer, it's not that easy. For instance, it only works on Windows, so if you have Linux or Mac, I'm not sure about Mac, but in Linux it's impossible. So I don't know if it's vulnerable in the US. If you have an LG device, I can test it if you want. So I'm not sure actually. They have pushed the update. Like you can, if you download the firmware from the website, you can update your device, but I'm not sure if it's like pushed up yet. So any more questions? Okay, thank you very much.